Assalamu alaikum and hello to everyone to this tutorial video where we are going to look at the solution of a rotary indexing table from an electronematic perspective. First of all, the problem description reads as using a rotary indexing table, plastic containers. Rotary indexing table, plastic containers are to be separated in linear sequence. Let us have an understanding of the actual industrial application where we have a rotary indexing table, and this table is called rotary because it rotates, and indexing because it has many slots and these slots are moving one step at a time. Hence the name indexing. These slots move one step at a time. Each slot contains a plastic container, and this table is being actuated by a pneumatic cylinder here via a pole. This is the pole. A pole is actually a lever which is connected to a toothed gear, also known as a ratchet, and this whole mechanism is called ratchet pole mechanism. So as the piston moves back and forth, in and out, extension, retraction, this pole moves the table by one step. So in the second cycle of the piston, the table moves another step, hence indexing name is given to this table. Moving to the next point, the whole system is being started by a push button, and the whole system is being stopped by pressing again the same button, and this is important for us to identify what kind of button is this. Is it a momentary button or a set button? We'll go into the details of this in other slides. From the other pages of the problem description, we can also identify some important details, such as we need to use double acting cylinder, we must apply indirect actuation, and the piston must be in oscillating motion. And of course, we need to come up with the pneumatic and electric circuit diagrams. In this slide, we are looking at the training aims. So what is being highlighted is what relate to our exercise 14. So first of all, we reiterate that we need to use indirect actuation with double acting cylinders, and the piston must be moving in oscillating motion. The slide outlines the components that need to be used, such as relays. Why? Because we have indirect actuation, and for that we need to use relays. And we have the signal input plate where we use the set button or push button, and we have double acting cylinder, we have two limit switches, and they are of two different types. One is actuated from left, another is actuated from right. Although we can use two limit switches of the same type, however, it could also be implemented using two different types, and the details of this going to proceed in the next slides. Lastly, we need to use a 5-2-way DCV. Why is it 5-2-way? Because we are using a double acting cylinder which could only be controlled by a 5-2-way. And bear in mind that it has double solenoid. Double solenoid. So it is a memory valve. Double solenoid, not spring return. Moving to the next slide, where if we were in the actual lab environment, we could actually use the signal input plate, where we have two types of buttons, either push buttons or set buttons. The push button could be normally open and normally closed depending on the contact that we select. Here it is normally closed, there it is normally open. Likewise for this head button, we can have normally open, we can also have normally closed. However, using FluidSim, we are not going to use this hardware. We are going to replace it by the simulation environment. Notice that push button could also be called momentary button, unbiased button, and also set button could also be called latch push button, detent switch, so on and so forth. In the problem description, we learned that the system has to be run continuously in oscillating motion. So we want to identify how to ensure that the circuit is run continuously. There are a number of implementations. We can either use latch circuit, whether that is dominant off or dominant on, or we can use a single set button. In the case of the latch circuit, bear in mind it is using two push buttons, and this is very important, two push buttons. As we learned from the beginning that the circuit operates by a single push button. You press it for the first time to start the system, and then you press it for the second time to stop the system. Therefore, we can conclude that the solution required is based on this kind of circuit. Although we can implement it using latch circuit, but that wasn't the way it is described in the beginning. Here we have two push buttons. Two push buttons. In the beginning, it was described single push button. Moving to this slide, where we are going to look at how to implement two limit switches of the same type, actuated from left, for example, or even actuated from right, and on the other hand, using two different limit switches as described by the problem. Both ways can achieve the same objective, that is having a piston rod head running in between these two limit switches. Here also we have the same piston rod head running between these two limit switches. The only difference is if you are going to use a similar limit switch actuated from left, then you need to have one of them flipped up or flipped upside down to achieve the same objective as if we had of two different types. So it is just a matter of configuration. Eventually, we arrive at the FluidSim drawing area where we need to place our pneumatic and electrical components. So from what we have learned, we need to have double acting cylinder. Make sure it is double acting. And then we need to have our 5-2-way DCV. DCV. 5-2-way. With double solenoids. With double solenoids. Make sure that each component has its own label. When A refers to the actuator, when V1 refers to the control element, and don't forget to label the solenoid, whether it is 1Y1 or 1Y2. As for the electrical circuit, the complete solution is not going to be shown as this is only a briefing. For sure we need to have our positive source, ground source, ground, and we need to have two solenoids. Each solenoid is being controlled by a relay. The solenoid is being controlled by a relay, and the second solenoid is being controlled by a second relay. And each relay must have its own contact. And each relay must have its own contact, at least one, whether that is a normally open contact or a normally closed contact, depending on the solution. But at least we know that we need to have a contact. And we have our set button, as we decided earlier, we need to have a set button for the start and the stop of the system. And we need to have two limit switches, and they are also indicated in the pneumatic circuit. We need to have them in our pneumatic circuit as well. As you can see, limit switch 1 is shown as initially actuated. This could be otherwise. However, in this case, limit switch 1 is already being pressed against by the piston rod, so it is in initially actuated condition. And from this we know that initially LS1 or limit switch 1 was actually normally open before being actuated. So this is the initial condition. When the piston presses against it, becomes normally closed, and this is the sign of initially actuated. So I think this is enough for the solution of this problem. I wish you the best, and I hope that you have benefited from this tutorial, and see you again.